3 weeks we westward bore, and when the storm was o'er, cloud-like we saw the shore stretching to leeward. There, for my lady's bower, built I the lofty tower which to this very hour is looking seaward.
So there's so much controversy about...
There's so much controversy. I guess different archaeologists, like I believe Brown came at one time, and over the years, different people, and they really haven't have any definite idea what it is, you know? And it's kind of nice to have something like that in Newport. Just, I'm not that familiar with Viking architecture, but I didn't think that they went to such things. I thought they were more like, were they called turns or something? And I think it's kind of tall for something like that. They built more of mounds, I would say. But it's a good conversation piece. It's Newport's conversation piece.
What does your dog think of all the controversy here?
She goes along with all of it. She's from Georgia, so she doesn't get involved.
So what, you ask me? You want to know who I think built the tower?
I want the scoop here.
You want the scoop?
Yeah.
This building, I believe, is the first building of the British Empire, and it operated as a horologium. You know what that means? Horo means hour, logium means place, a building that keeps track of time. But the interior works as a camera obscura, solar disk calendar room. And if you want to find out what that is, you'll have to come into my museum, because I have recreated one right there.
So in the museum, I want to point out some pictures. Before the tower, before these houses were built, just to the west of the tower once had an incredible view over the entire bay, all the way over to Jamestown and to the mainland beyond. And it has this beautiful circularity you can see up at the top of it. Well, inside the tower, there's actually two floors. There are beam sockets here for the first floor, and this is the level of the second floor. In this room is a fireplace and three windows. That's the northeast window, and then the south window is over here, and I'm photographing from the west window. And here's Professor Penhallow showing us the alignments of the various, the sun alignment, where you look through these two windows. On the winter solstice, the sun starts here, and it rises and comes up, and boom, shines right through both the windows. And the other alignment is the lunar-moon alignment, where the moon comes up on that one day, December 25th, 1996. Boom! There it is, right through these other pair of windows. So he said, whoever built this tower knew about astronomy. Now, to show you that, I'm going to have to close off the door, turn off the lights, and make this room dark, except for one small hole. There's the hole right here. So with all the lights out, but with one small hole, the image of what's outside will magically appear on the inside. So here's this whiteboard, and you can see the image of this car upside down backwards, and the cars driving by on Bellevue Avenue. This goes a car on Guild Street driving by. In other words, we've created, this goes a truck, we've created a giant camera. We are inside the camera. That's the lens, and this is the film plane, and everything is upside down. Now, what did Professor Penhallow mean? Why would he say, did he mean this was the movie theater inside of this ancient building? Well, what he meant was this. I'm going to have to show you a different camera obscura. Now this one, instead of having a large hole that has a lens in it, I'm going to show you one that has just a smaller hole. And here is the image of what's outside. This is the trees that are in the park right here. This is the cars and such. Now, see that bright spot right there? That's the image of the sun, and you'll see that projected down onto the ground, it makes what's called a solar disk. As the sun moves across the sky during the day, it makes a wide arc from east to west. But inside a camera obscura, it goes the opposite way. When I come in the morning, the sun is here at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. You see the solar disk is right about there at 11:30, and then at 12 o'clock, it goes through here, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and then it will set over here. And then in the winter, when it makes a lower arc in the sky, the solar disk is up here at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. Here it crosses 12, or the noon or meridiana line, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then it slowly sets outside. In the fall and spring, it goes through the middle here. So in other words, the path of the sun is here, here in the summer, and then in the fall it's here, and then it's here in the winter. And then it works its way back down, in spring it's here, and then in summer it's here again. So in other words, if the solar disk is here, you can say, well, it's about 11:15, a little before the fall equinox. It tells you the time of day and the day of the year. I studied the history of the camera obscura, and I found that during the Renaissance, they converted these giant cathedrals that were already in existence into camera obscura rooms. There's the aperture, and there's the meridiana line, or the noon line. This still exists in Rome today. All of a sudden, serendipity happens. I was reading a book in the library, and it says, historical names for Narragansett Bay. And then I saw this entry, the John D. Bay and River, 1583. 1583? That's 20 years, that's 40 years before the Pilgrims. Why would it be named after this Englishman? So I studied John D., and I found out that he was a mathematician, astronomer, an expert on navigation and cartography. He had a library of over 4,000 books in his library, and he wrote down every book that he has. We have we know exactly the compendium of all of his books that he owned in his library. Now, he wrote a series of books to Queen Elizabeth, explaining to her that she had a legal right to all of North America, except for Florida, because Spain was already in Florida. And he coined the term the British Empire. He says because King Arthur, Prince Madoc, and John of Sebastian Cabot had been to the New World, England had a legal right to it. 1 month later, the Queen gives all of North America to one of her bravest courtiers, Sir Humphrey Gilbert. So what happened? Well, in 1583, five ships set sail from Plymouth, England, under the leadership of Sir Humphrey Gilbert. One ship got a contagious disease, and they had to head back. The other four ships made it to St. John's in Newfoundland, but on the way down the coast, they hit a tempest. First, they lost their largest supply ship, then Sir Humphrey Gilbert's ship got swallowed by a wave, and he drowned. The whole colonization effort came to a grinding halt, because Letters Patent was in his name. But 1 year later, the Queen deeded all of North America to his younger half-brother, Sir Walter Raleigh. Now, David Beers Quinn, who explored all of this and wrote all about it in the 1970s, found that the Spanish ambassador to London had written letters back to King Philip II of Spain, in which he said there was a preliminary expedition that happened in 1582. Two ships and a pinnace under the leadership of Anthony Brigham came to the New World, stayed here for 9 months, and I claim they built this tower to be the city center of this first Elizabethan colony in the New World. And this is what I think the tower originally looked like. In other words, it would have been entirely all plastered over and then painted it with a technique called sgraffito, which means they would paint in the lines of shadowing to make it look like faux stone or faux brick or faux marble. There was a foot and a half of feet, and then this was all plastered over, and on these shelves that stick out would have been an entablature. And then above that would have been these pilasters that would have been held on with metal cramp irons, and then another wooden entablature on top, and the dome would have had a hole in it, and on the floor of the dome room would have been one of these camera obscura solar disk calendar rooms. On the Benedict Arnold chair, there's this strange symbol on the side, and very briefly, besides hiding his initials, B and A, it has these three circles that are all exactly 2 1/8 inches in diameter. And what I found was that the size of the solar disk varies upon distance. And when the solar disk is an inch away if it's about a foot away, it's very small. It's about a half an inch in diameter. And it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. At 18 and a half feet, if the sun was coming through, the solar disk makes a 2 1/8 inch diameter disk. So when I saw this, I knew that Benedict Arnold knew about the astronomy in the tower. Benedict Arnold not only knew about this not only knew about the astronomy of the tower, he knew about the colonization effort of 1583. And the Elizabethans and John Dee had a secret code symbol for the expedition, and he had a secret code name for it. And the code name was Rhodi, which is Greek for rose or road. And that's where Benedict Arnold got the idea of naming it Rhode Island. Now, all of my work is based on the study of Elizabethan history, New England history, Rhode Island history, John Dee, Buckminster Fuller, and the history of mathematics, astronomy, optics, and time.